from the site of Vancouver, BC, in Expo 86. I had to think about that one. With Platinum Blonde saying, there is
good rocking
tonight.
Katrina from Katrina and the Wave, and you're watching Good Rocking Tonight.
Review of the Beatles' live performance in Vancouver 22 years ago, this very night, August 22nd, 1964. Seldom in Vancouver's entertainment history have so many, 16,000, paid so much, $5.25 top price, for so little, 27 minutes, as did the audience which screamed at the Beatles in Empire Stadium Saturday night. As a music critic, I have had to subject my eardrums to more than a little of the cacophony which currently dominates the hit parade, but the stuff shouted by these Liverpudlian tonsorial horrors left me particularly unimpressed. I perceive nothing that made them better or worse than any number of the less ballyhooed groups, either as vocalists or instrumentalists. They sounded just as loud, just as monotonous, and just as unmusical. I do not know how it came, why it came, and when it will go away, but go away, the Beatles phenomenon will, and with it will go the Beatles. The day is yet to come. When it does, music lovers everywhere can rejoice. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Now look at this. Notice the top five singles are done by the Beatles. No one but no one has done that before or has since. Hardly surprising that they are still the world's all-time number one group. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Come to Expo.
Come to World Stage 86.
Monday nights at 7 on CBC.
Katrina, welcome to Vancouver.
Thank you, Terry.
Steve.
Stu, sorry.
You've, what I'd really like to get from you, first of all, is a little history of Katrina and the Waves. The last time you were here was a few years ago.
Yeah, I think the last time I was here was pre-Walking on Sunshine, so you guys had a lot of guts to have me on the show as a mere peasant of a nobody.
We had a feeling.
We had a feeling, yes. Just goes to prove Canadians have exceedingly good taste in music. Yeah, a brief history about the band. Well, it all started for me when I was born in Topeka, Kansas, and my father's in the Air Force, so we moved to Georgia, Massachusetts, California, Florida, Germany, Holland, and England, where I've lived for the past 10 years. I joined a church choir and I met bassist Vince Dela Cruz, and he said, you've got a good voice. So we put together a band. It was called Mama's Cooking. Later on, we met Alex Cooper, Kimberly Real, and we put a band together called Katrina and the Waves.
That's 10.
Three.
All right, Walking on Sunshine, which was your first hit. Can you tell me about the video?
You're right. This is a video show, isn't it? So We have to talk about videos. Well, this band hates making videos. I'm sure you saw the Walking on Sunshine video. Well, That was like the first video we ever made, and we thought, well, let's make it look like it's warm outside. It was the 3rd of February in England, along the Thames in London, which is bloody cold. Can you say bloody?
You can.
Very darned cold. So we were going along to get Katrina in a short-sleeve shirt and paint her arms brown, and we'll make it look like it's the middle of summer, and she's having a great time. Yeah, no, they honestly thought we could get away with it. And I'm walking along singing, I'm walking on sunshine, and there's, you know, steam pouring out of my mouth, and you can see the goosebumps from a mile away.
Because of Walking on Sunshine, you just like making videos, period, now? Is that
well, no, I got in this business to sing. You know, I was 16 years old, and I thought, gee, there's something here. You know, thanks, Mom and Dad, and all that. And I decided I could actually sing and make some money doing it and have some fun. And that was it. I just wanted to sing. I wanted to make records, and I wanted to sing live. And then all of a sudden in this business, it's, can you try on this dress? And, well, you have to be a model, a public relations person, a great talker, an insomniac, because you don't get any sleep in this business, an actress, a movie director, a producer. You know, you have to be all kinds of things these days, and one of the things I really despise doing is videos, just because it's so unrepresentative.
Well, if it's any consolation at all, you don't come across as disliking them at all. Actually, you come across as having a whole lot of fun, so one could be really deceived.
No, it's funny you should say that, because I do get a lot of fan mail that says, keep making those good videos. We know you enjoy making them, because you always look like you're having such a great time. And it's good if people think you are. That's the whole point, is to sell yourself in the videos. It's your big chance.
You've been living in England for the past little while. Is that now your home?
Well, when you're in the position I'm in, you don't really have a home. It's, you know, traveling all the time, moving all the time. We moved every 2 years, so I don't really have a home, and I'm not aware of this concept of homesickness. So it comes in handy. That's why I think this is the perfect life for me, being in a rock and roll band, because I love hotels and motels and motel soap and shampoo, and the rope they give you in the Four Seasons are great. So.
Do you collect the little paper bands that come across the toilet seat that say you sanitize for your protection?
No, you don't get those in the Four Seasons. You just take it for granted that it has been sanitized. Mind you, I caught one of the maids using my bathroom one time. It really, really upset me.
I can tell. You're still fuming. When was the last time that you were back in England?
We go there every once in a while, and I sort of check into my home and pay my bills and stuff, but I guess we were there a couple of months ago. We've been on the road for 2 years. It's been really crazy. We're taking the month of September off and get back to doing normal things like washing dishes and making scrambled eggs and taking out the trash and vacuuming. All that stuff is going to be a whole new adventure for this kid.
What could be cooler than doing Johnny Carson?
Yeah, I don't know what's wrong with Johnny Carson. He must have a really weird sense of humor or something. The thing about Carson is, I was saying to you earlier in makeup, Jill, that I can't figure out if it's a really cool thing to do or a really uncool thing to do, Johnny Carson, and to do it twice. So I figure it's so uncool, it's cool.
What would be cooler? What would you rather do?
Well, I suppose right now David Letterman is really cool, but because he's obviously cool, and he's on the cover of People and all that, I suppose that makes him a bit uncool.
Yeah.
See, the thing about this band is we always try to do, not try to do, but we always usually end up doing things that are really uncool, like wearing tennis shoes. There's one. And dirty, filthy black trousers and jean jackets and have hairstyles like this and black eyes. You going to talk about my black eyes?
Yes, yes. What eye is it? Okay, that one.
This eye right here.
And this came from you should see the other guy's situation, right? Was backstage, something got carried away.
Sometimes fans get a little carried away, and I don't mind being loved and adored, but this was a bit ridiculous. Some people really enjoy pain and giving other people pain. You know that sort of thing? What's it called, masochism or something?
Yeah, it's the one.
Yeah, I'm not really into that, I must admit, but I didn't hesitate to put my shoe firmly in the middle of his forehead. He's got a big Katrina and the Waves rubber stamp on his forehead.
Mark Holmes and Kenny McLean from Platinum Blonde, welcome back to Vancouver.
Thank you very much.
This tour has been going incredible for you. We heard a lot of things from Seattle, maybe you want to talk about that. You did some incredible record setting.
Yeah, well, they got back to us and said the first show sold out in like 25 minutes. And I think Bruce Springsteen's America record was like 30 minutes or something like that. They based it on a lot of different things like credit card size of the venue and whatnot, but it all gets averaged out. You can average out how big a 200 hole sells out to a 3,000 or 4,000 hole to a 60,000, how they sell out. But apparently, he held the record in 18 minutes to sell out.
Holy cow.
The second show is announced to sell out in 18 minutes. And so there you go.
I guess it goes without saying the crowd response was
really
incredible.
Nice.
Yeah.
Very, very good.
I thought they were all Canadians down there, didn't you? But hey, they weren't.
But doing an exhibition type of tour this time around, playing everything from the Klondike Days and Saskatoon and everything.
Yeah.
How does that differ from your usual tour, or is there a difference?
Well, we have to travel on horse and carts in the Klondike Days. It's really hard for the crew, the equipment loading on, Those wooden wheels don't hold up too good.
Especially the square ones.
The square ones.
It's a little bit less organized.
Yeah.
It's very hectic, and a lot of things go wrong.
Yeah. It's a lot of fun, isn't it, though?
Yeah,
it's more hectic.
So we just take things a little easier.
Yeah, so it'd be like being the Rolling Stones, you go on without sound checks and
just... Yeah, we just dirt whatever comes out. I think we're getting a little bit closer to the people this time around. Before was a more contrived show, this time we don't know what the hell we're doing. We do it.
And also I was wondering, what was new with Platinum Blonde? I haven't heard much of them for a while. I've seen pictures of them, and they look a lot different, but I don't know what they've been up to lately.
Well, we change a lot of image, not really our image. We took another shoot with Demo.
Took some
Demo for Barry, And we just looked a little bit different then. We just came out of the pub and we had our gear on.
And he said, can I shoot you guys like that? And we went in and we did the cover for Hungry Eyes. That's it, really.
Hungry Eyes video, is that shot in Quebec? Was that the one shot in Quebec
City? Quebec City.
Yeah. Well, we were going to do a video. It's part of a live special. It's part of the whole life. We're going to do a video to it, but there's so many complications on what storyline to the video. I don't think it just handle doing another video to the record, so we just put that out. You know, it's not too disappointing to anybody, but, you know, you still get to see the crowd. And we haven't had a live video out since Nasty Love, and that was first album, so I reckon one do every record, at least one.
Jennifer Caraveau wants to see Crying Over You, the video Crying Over You, and to know the story behind Crying Over You.
Actually, the video is a creation, basically, of Robert Quarterly. Is it Quarterly or Quarterly?
Quarterly. Quarterly. Depends if you're New York, it's Quarterly.
If you know more, it's Quarterly. Quarterly.
Good.
Okay, anyway, this is inventionist. But the real meaning of the song is a mask of innocence, you know. Once you get fooled by some people who can really, you know, fish you in, which I've gotten fooled by, everybody's gotten fooled by, once you know where they are and what they do, you're not going to be crying over them anymore, because often you do. And that's it. Crying
over you. Before we talk to David Foster, here's this week's Top 20 Singles Countdown. 4-3, Jermaine Stewart. Up 3-2, Wham! And this week's new champion, Peter Cetera.
On board the Chartmaker with David Foster and daughter Amy. David, first of all...
Sister Amy. No,
sister.
Daughter Amy, you're right.
I'm sorry, of course.
Daughter Amy.
David, first of all, when people are seeing this, you are actually not here. You are at a dinner. And a dinner is the kickoff to a very special event this weekend. You want to run it down for me?
Right. As people are watching this right now, we're at the celebrity softball game in Victoria. I got involved in a girl about a year ago named Rachel Sharma, who I think everybody in at least Western Canada is familiar with. She had a couple of liver transplants and didn't make it, but that was unfortunate, but the fortunate thing is that she brought the awareness to me, and now I'm trying to bring it to the attention of everybody else. There's a million problems out there, but we're focused on this one, which is organ transplants for children, and it really is a serious problem. There's hundreds of children waiting right now for organs in British Columbia alone, let alone the rest of Canada. So we're educating ourselves and we're learning. We hope to raise a bunch of money. The softball tournament is August 23rd in Victoria. The dinner I'm at right this second, as you can plainly see. And we appreciate you taking the time for us to mention it because we think it's a real worthwhile cause. And hopefully in the future, more parents will be able to hang with their kids and watch them grow this old and, God forbid, even older.
All right, tell me who's involved.
Olivia's going to be there. She's there right now as we speak. Uh-huh. Ray Parker, the guys in Chicago. And Tommy Chong, Rob Lowe, Wayne Gretzky, Burt Bacharach, who's one of my heroes, to name a few. Platinum Blonde. And the real exciting thing is, I guess I can tell it now because it's not airing until the night of the banquet. The people don't know, but all these people are going to perform. So I'm putting the show, I've put the show together, as a matter of fact, and all these people are performing tonight, one song each, and the whole show is going to be about an hour and a half long, and it should be. Great.
David, right now you have a number one song in Canada. You want to tell me about it?
The song is called Glory of Love, and we wrote it for The Karate Kid 2. Peter Cetera and I wrote it together. And interestingly enough, we wrote it in Vancouver, which is kind of a nice thing to do. Mm-hmm. Pretty inspirational there in West Vancouver, overlooking the ocean, and we just came up with it in about 20 minutes. And then, of course, Peter elaborated on the lyrics. That didn't come in the first 20 minutes. But I didn't produce this record, though, and as you can see, it really hurt the record, because it only went to number one. Would have done much better if I had produced it. But it kind
kind of sounds like the Chicago sound, which Peter and I have kind of helped along for the last 5 years. And now the new Chicago album is coming out in about a month. And our first single, which I did produce but didn't write, is a song called 25 or 64, a remake of the old 25 or 64. And it is hot. And
tell me about it. That's one of my favorite songs.
Yeah.
Can you give me a little hint of that?
Well, we came up with a new groove. Jimmy Pankow, the trombone player, came up with a new groove for the song. But dig this, like when we were trying to figure out what song to do to remake, because I came up with the idea to remake an old song. I said, guys, go home and get all your old albums and bring them all into the studio, and we're all going to sit around and listen to all your songs and pick the perfect one to be remade. And it was really a thrill to have all the guys there and all their albums. They all brought in their albums. We put them on the turntable, and we listened to every song of the first 7 albums. And it really was terrific. And there was a lot of songs that just, they were just too perfectly classic, like Does Anybody Know What Time It Is? And Saturday in the Park and Make Me Smile. They were just so classic, we couldn't touch them. But I think this worked, and I think it's going to be great. And the guy that did the cinematography for Blade Runner, the film, is doing the video.
Oh.
And I think it's just going to be really, really hot. So perhaps Peter Cetera and Chicago and Warner Brothers Records will all win with the flip.
If you've listened to music over the past year, you will know that Lionel Richie has finally come out from behind Michael Jackson's giant shadow to stand in his own spotlight with a huge album, Can't Slow Down, featuring no less than 5 hit singles. And in doing so, winning almost all of the top music awards on both sides of the Atlantic. Here's Lionel's reaction to winning a Grammy.
It's an outrageous feeling right now. I have to tell you, it's probably numbing right now to understand exactly what has gone down. But this last 2 months probably has been the strangest 2 months of my life, but wonderful, wonderful. Believe it or not, I've been nominated 20 times and I only have 1 Grammy. I can now take home 2 more. So it's kind of a good feeling.
We are going to take you backstage once again to the Grammys to pick up on the comments of Lionel Richie, who, after leaving the relative security of the Commodores, completely changed his life with one lone hit, Lady, written for his friend Kenny Rogers. It, of course, went number 1 across the board on all charts. And from that moment on, there was no turning back for this artist. It was straight to the top for the man from Motown, the one and only Lionel Richie.
Well, I'll tell you now, Album of the Year is not too shabby. Between Album of the Year and Song of the Year, you can't go wrong. But tonight was real special because considering Producer of the Year, and we split that with David Foster, I mean, to me, that's a milestone. It's brand spanking new for me. And the fact that James Carmichael won it with me as my co-producer, I think he's long overdue, and I love the man. We're not doing too bad. Album, Song of the Year, and Producer, that's pretty good. What happened is that my hardest artist as a producer, Lionel Richie, is about to kill me. I don't have the time that I used to have to go out and play with other artists. In fact, it was very, very difficult to pull off the Missing You single with Diana because I was doing it while I was on the road with her. But again, I'm going to try to find some time. I love to play with some of these people now. David Foster, you know, David wrote and we co-wrote and co-produced The Only One that's on my Can't Slow Down album. It's just so ironic that he's working on the Canadian program for the African Relief. I have not heard the track. I heard it's wonderful. Well, if it's David Foster, I don't have to worry about it. But the fact that we won together tonight, oh, what a great feeling.
Much talent now.
A guy said something, I heard it years ago. He said, the road to success is cluttered by those coming back. And a great example of that is Tina Turner tonight. Whenever you say, do you see artists on the horizon, there's so many artists out there that are qualified for that peak position, I cannot start with just one name. Again, considering 4 years ago, Prince was booed off of the stage at the Rolling Stones concert, and he's back now at the top of his career. Considering Michael Jackson's Off the Walls album only received 1 or 2 nominations, I think it was. And again, Thriller, he had to come back with Thriller to make his statement. I can't call up a name. All I can say to you is that the talent is there. I love Cyndi Lauper. I think she's wonderful.
As you know, like David Foster in Canada, Lionel Richie was one of the major forces behind the USA for Africa recording session, We Are the World. He co-wrote the song with Michael Jackson. Isn't that ironic? Here are his comments about the project after the Grammys.
It came up with an idea. Someone, Harold Belafonte, called on the phone and said, wish you would get involved with the hungry people of Africa. And I said, a great idea. I think I'll write a song. And I ran it by Quincy. And Quincy said, great. I was talking to Michael on the phone, and he said, I'd love to do something with you. The next thing I knew, there were 41 to 45 superstars in a room singing We Are the World. And I will tell you, it makes me feel real good to know that in this world of computers and Star Wars talk, that something like life is important again. And we want to make it fashionable. And the great part about it is these wonderful artists came and said, we'll give of our time, we'll give of our energies, we'll give of our creativity, and let's save these people.